Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this afternoon's seminar here at the Norwegian Institute of International Affairs. My name is Helge Blokkesrud, and I'm an associate professor at the University of Oslo and a senior researcher here at the Norwegian Institute of International Affairs. And it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the seminar on Russia's new state ideology, engineering structures and actors. According to Article 13 of the Russian Constitution, no ideology may be instituted as a state-sponsored or mandatory ideology in the Russian Federation. At the same time, in our Legitimus project, we carried out a survey in Russia back in 2021, where we, among other things, asked about how people felt about state ideology, and no less than 78% of our respondents responded in the affirmative, indicating that there might be some popular demand from below for some kind of ideological guidelines. In this afternoon's seminar, we ask how the war has affected the Kremlin's thinking around a new state ideology. And to help us understand this and answer this question, we have our colleague and good friend that we have collaborated with for many years, Professor Marlene Laruelle, who I think in this audience probably does not need an introduction, but for those who have not encountered or met with Marlene yet, she is a director of the Institute for European, Russian and Eurasian Studies at George Washington University in DC. And she's somewhat of a force of nature when it comes to researching and publishing and organizing initiatives when it comes to Russian affairs, and provided insightful contribution to the research agenda from everything from the Arctic to Central Asia, from Eurasianism across Russian nationalism, and more recently to the study of illiberalism. Marlene will speak for some 40-45 minutes before we open up the floor for Q&A. I am glad to say that this seminar is streamed online via NUPI's YouTube channel. And if you want also to go back to look at the discussion afterwards, you will find it on the YouTube channel. I would encourage our audience that follow this seminar online to send in questions early on, so that we also can include you in the Q&A afterwards. And finally, I would just like to say that this seminar is organized as part of our joint Research Council funded project that we have together with the University of Oslo, Values-Based Legitimation in Authoritarian States, Top-Down versus Bottom-Up Strategies. The Case of Russia, a very cumbersome title, but in short, Legitus. But without further ado, I'd like to give the floor to Marlene.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for the invitation. I'm delighted to be here with you today and to present you some of the current research I'm doing on what is happening in Russia in terms of kind of ideology production. And so you will see that I will be talking about the contents of ideology, not so much, but more about the structure, the institution, on how do we produce, how it is produced. So what I'm really interested is to look at the institutional construction, right? All the little hands that works together, the state structure, the funding mechanism, even if I will not really address here the funding issue. I think generally the literature on ideological production in Russia has been very much the Western literature has been very much focused on, you know, what is happening in Putin's mind, who is he reading, who is influencing him, can we identify the guru or this kind of figure. And I think it's a much more it's too much centered on some particular figure, and we are missing the big, the bureaucratic mechanism that help us, that helps Russia producing ideology. There is also a lot of secondary actors that are usually never studied, never present, and that who I think play a big role. So there is, I think, the need to understand things like moving away from what is happening in Putin's brain and who is influencing him, but looking at ideology as the mechanism that is produced bureaucratically with its own structure, that is co-opting civil society, that is testing mechanisms and narratives to the public opinion, where you have top-down and bottom-up kind of interaction, and trying to have this kind of more structural overview of what is happening. And for that, I use the notion of ideological infrastructure. The notion as such, the concept, exists under the label of intellectual infrastructure, and it's usually used by the literature on kind of property rights. So it's not exactly what I'm doing here. So I'm kind of extracting that notion to use it to say that while we tend to have looked, I think, too much on the soft component of infrastructure, the kind of ideational, we have been missing the more hard infrastructure, which is the institutional one, and trying to put all that together. And so this project that I'm presenting is part of a broader research that will look more at this kind of ideological infrastructure, and also looking at ideology at the market. I think it's something that we tend very often not to put into the picture, is that Russia is functioning on many aspects as both a country where the state is still very much powerful, but you also have a lot of neoliberal mechanisms, and producing ideology in the market. You can make money on it, right? It's a business almost like any other, and you have people, institutions, private firms who specialize in producing ideology for federal institutions, the Moscow government, the region, and so on. And I think we usually don't have a large study of that, and then something that I will not be presenting here today, but that I'm doing, it's looking at, you know, all the grants, the presidential grants, but also the different grants given by different Russian institutions, to whom, right? Who is getting grants to produce meanings in terms of what is legitimate for the ideological production in Russia. If we look at the way the idea of a state ideology has been evolving in Russia, a lot of debates among scholars are based on or depends on the question on how do we define ideology. You will have people who will tell you, yeah, well, of course, Russia has an ideology. I mean, the Putin regime is very much an ideological one, and Putin himself is kind of animated by belief. You will have another school that will tell you, well, there is nothing similar to kind of Marxist-Leninism doctrine in Russia today. So depending on how you define ideology, you can get a positive or a negative answer about what do we have in Russia, even before the beginning of the full-scale invasion of Ukraine last year. If you use ideology, and I tend to use it as a set of beliefs about how the world should be, then there is an ideology in Russia the same way as there is an ideology everywhere, right? We are all kind of animated by a certain vision of our own life, the society, the world order. And so I try to dissociate ideology as this kind of set of belief from a more kind of state ideology in the sense of a doctrine that would be produced with its kind of holy text that has to be learned and so on. And I think it's important to keep that distinctions. In the literature, there have been also a lot of discussion about what is the role of ideology in the Putin's regime itself. Do we want to see the Putin's regimes as being having a very instrumental, cynical, opportunistic use of ideology, playing with some and then changing? Or do we want to see Putin and people around him are deeply animated by ideology? And here also you have the two schools. And in a sense, they both bring arguments that make sense depending on how you want to define ideology. So if you take ideology as a kind of very broad set of beliefs that still have some articulation, well, yeah, Russian elites and the society, they do have ideologies. Maybe plural, right? Not one, but several. This ideology, they have evolved. I think if we look at Putin at the beginning of his presidential mandate in the early 2000s, already had a clear vision of what he wanted for Russia in terms of, you know, rebuilding the Russian state, recentralizing, being a great power, reinforcing patriotism, having a kind of healthy patriotic society. And then what we have now, you can interpret it in two different ways. You can say, well, Putin already was the same, and he's just kind of put in application everything he was dreaming of to do in the 2000s, but it took him time to be able to invade Ukraine. Or on the contrary, you feel like, okay, maybe the global vision of Russia was there, but the tools to get that Russia that was kind of dreamt evolved along the 23 years of Putin's regime, or the 30-something years if you begin since the collapse of the Soviet Union. And I think while there was still a lot of hope in the early 2000s, gradually what we have seen arriving over the two decades of Putin's regime is a lot of resentment, disillusion, kind of misunderstanding of what was happening in the relationship with the West, in the relationship with the former Soviet Republic, and then gradually a conspiracy reading of the world that now has really genuinely become part of especially the foreign policy culture of the Russian elites. So you had some kind of deeply seated ideological belief in the sense of a set of worldviews that were there, both in the Russian society in a pluralistic way and in the Russian elites, and then gradually a kind of resentment, disillusion. So you may want the same, for example, patriotism, but the way you think you can implement that patriotism has changed, in the sense that now if it's not working in a smooth way, then it's where you have state institution arriving and trying to sponsor in a top-down mechanism or dynamic, kind of building ideological repertoire, narrative, paradigms that then will be shared to the population, always in a kind of co-creational manner. And also what has been really evolving, it's all the coercive toolkits that the state is employing to put pressure on the society, and especially on the part of the society that doesn't want to share what is the kind of the state mainstream ideology. So the state languages has been evolving, but there was still, I think, since the beginning, a certain global vision of what should be Russia. So I think it's important to try to be granular in our analysis of what we define as an ideology. How did it evolve? How did it get kind of, it had sedimentation over the years, depending on how the regime was evolving domestically and in interaction with the rest of the world, and especially with the West. So the notion I use to try to look at that, it's the notion of ecosystem. I use ecosystem in a way of looking at the Kremlin as a kind of group a system with different ecosystem in it, made of institution, patrons, ideological entrepreneur, private funder, you know, media, technique, and all these groups. They work both in cooperation and in competition with each other. And I think that's important to understand this mechanism of cooperation and competition at the same time if we want to understand, for example, now the fight between Prigozhin and Shoigu, right? It's both competition and cooperation, and that the way the system has been functioning since the beginning, it can be more difficult, more competition than cooperation at some time, but you have different groups that function in different concentric circles with different type of access to the presidential administration. Some people are, or patrons are, inside the system. Some are outside, right? Not everybody can access Putin himself. Very few people can do that. So people access someone at the presidential administration, or they access only someone who then someone can access the presidential administration. So you have all this kind of distance from the core center that have to be taken into consideration. I think very often the Western media tend to miss totally that aspect, and that's where you find things like, you know, Dugin is the guru of Putin. Well, Dugin probably never met Putin, right? So being the guru is not like, it's a pretty difficult see if you never met that person. So there are a lot of all these kind of concentric circles and elements that have to be taken into consideration, and also something on which the literature has been well developed, which is that you have the Russian official state, the presidential administration, the government, you know, the technocrats. And then you have a kind of parallel state, an informal state, which may be, you know, Putin's personal connection with some oligarchs, funders, friends, you know, people he trusts. The presidential administration, the big figure, have also their own informal network. It can be business, can be friendship, it can be kind of a protection, or one is the patron or the other. All these informal relationships are the things that are difficult, of course, to capture for us, because it's not an easy reading like an administrative status, but it's very important, and I'm mentioning that because I think the relationship between the official state and this kind of informal state has been evolving since the beginning of the full-scale invasion. And then when we speak about kind of ideological production, we often tend to mix what I define as upstream and downstream, right? Are we looking at who is feeding Putin and the presidential administration with ideological content, right? Who are the ghostwriters that are preparing the text, selecting the quotation that Putin will be having in a speech, or who is doing all that work? And then the upstream, right, aspect. The downstream is that once Putin said something or an official decree was passed, you have a lot of people whose job is to make business of that, right? Spread it on the news, you know, on the television, write about that, promote that, try to transform that into a public policy, try to spread that to a different audience. And usually in the literature about ideology, we usually don't really define its upstream or dissociate its upstream to the downstream aspect. For example, the literature about Dugin influence, to go back on that, is that upstream or downstream? Are we trying to see that it's Dugin writing and then someone is reading Dugin's writing, retranscribing that and sending that up to the presidential administration? Or do we believe that once Putin or someone at the presidential administration decided for some narrative, then Dugin is on the downstream side, so then you say, okay, I will write a book on that and kind of promote it, publish on that, right? It's usually not really studied in this kind of upstream, downstream aspect. And I think that's important because the people we tend to interpret as being the influential people may just be influencer on the other side, right? Just kind of type of Vladimir Solovyov on television, right? Spreading the messaging with different tonality, color, and so on. So all to give you all these kind of nuances that I think are necessary if we try to kind of disentangle what is happening in terms of the ideological production. So what we had since February 24 is, of course, a rapid escalation of ideological production with always an ambiguity, which is to know if the Kremlin interested in mobilizing the population in favor of the war or in demobilizing it in favor of just do you be busy with your private life and trust the government in doing what is right for Russia. And the regime needs both, right? It needs people to be largely demobilized because that's the way the Russian regime has been working in sending people back to their private life and being alone in managing the decision. At the same time, if you are in a war or in a so-called special military operation context, you need some mobilization. You need people to showcase some enthusiasm, support, you need people to volunteer or to accept to be mobilized. So there is this tension in the narrative and in the strategies of the Kremlin. I think the global idea was like, how can we mobilize and make the population realize that, well, Russia is under threat, now fighting against the so-called collective West over Ukraine, and at the same time, you don't want to alarm people too much because people need to be able to continue their everyday life. Otherwise, the contract that the regime is having with the population, which is let us do the war in Ukraine, just get busy with your own life and trust us, would be kind of difficult. So the ideological landscape, it should be both kind of comforting, a little bit alarmist, but not too much. So it's a kind of difficult balance to have. The way it has been working is, of course, all the repressive mechanisms have accelerated rapidly after February 24, really now with a much stronger censorship on everything that was political, what already the case before, but on culture, on books, on art, and also all the kind of semantic tropes that were used by the regime really got kind of, we can see the calcification. It's become less and less easy to play with terms, right? Before you had really a kind of pretty free use of a lot of notion, and then gradually you can see, right, the way you speak about, you should speak about the great patriotic war, there are less and less room of maneuver, the way you want to speak about the 90s, the way you want to speak about the collapse of the Soviet Union, all the key elements are getting kind of more and more stabilized or rigidified in the narrative. There was already a decree listing the list of traditional spiritual and moral values of the Russian state that was published before the war. The two kind of, or the key elements that we had after February 24 in terms of kind of building a new state ideology have been so launching weekly classes for school children about talking about what is important, razgovor o vazhnom, and then for universities to be implemented at the next academic year, a new class called Fundamentals of Russian Statehood. I will be coming back on that. There have been processes of rewriting textbook, a really strong increase in military patriotic education for young people, and everything that is called Z culture, so Z being the letter symbolizing the special military operation, and a lot of pop culture element getting activated. And here also it's something that I will be looking at in the bigger project, which is that when we discuss ideology in Russia, we usually tend to think about text, right? We have a textual definition of ideology. And of course, textual ideology is not something that is easy to consume for an average citizen. And so in fact, you have a lot of ideological contents that are going through visual or musical element. And that's it's an important element of popular culture where the state can send messages, and then you have here also actors who decide to play with that part of the business of producing culture. So I think we have globally been looking too much at ideology as a textual production and not enough at the kind of pop culture aspect, which I think has become very evident as being a tool that the Putin's regime has been using, in fact, in the early 90s, right? You always had a kind of celebrity politics in the Russian regime, both at home and abroad, that have been important and that continues to be developed after February 24. So what we have now is that for very long, as Helge was saying, the Russian state and the main figure of the regime was very clear with the fact that Russia doesn't need a state ideology, right? Because all the people who are in power now in Russia are people who remember the collapse of the Soviet Union and the fact that the Marxist-Leninist ideology was really something that was demobilizing citizens and not mobilizing them 35 years ago. And so there is still this fear that, okay, if we try to build something that is look too rigid, that look like the Marxist-Leninist, that will not work, right? The population will not buy it, and the elites themselves will not be interested in trying to fit, right? So it needs to be an ideology that is still flexible enough to be acceptable and to be sold to the population without going back to a kind of Soviet indoctrination with a very rigid text. And so we can see since February 24 that there have been tension about what should be done around that. And so there have been, especially a few months, I mean, in May, some discussion about should we abolish this famous Article 13 of the Constitution that said that Russia cannot have a state ideology, with some figure mostly coming from the security services, but also Dmitry Medvedev, the former president, who is now among the hawks in Russia, saying like, well, hey, given the context of the special military operation, we have to abolish that and be able to kind of promote a state ideology. And then you have other figures, often from the Ministry of Justice, saying, ooh, that would be really complicated to abolish an article of the Constitution. Maybe we don't need that. We had already constitutional amendment in 2020 that are already bringing some element of an ideology. We can just have a national idea as something that is very flexible and kind of soft version of a state ideology without having to change the legislation. So you can see that inside the regime, there is kind of tensions about the level of indoctrination that should be brought to the population, and still a pretty kind of functional and kind of technocratic understanding of how you use ideology or you don't use it. And as Helge was mentioning, the survey we did in 2021 was showing pretty kind of positive answer about Russian citizens asking or being in favor of a state ideology, even if we can discuss what they mean, meant by state ideology, not what the regime is meaning, but something much more about just, you know, consolidating a social order where you can have some predictability about what life and shared values mean, but not something where you would have to sit and kind of learn a new text and answer questions. So the as I was saying, this there is tensions in the regime now about like, should we officialize a state ideology or what we already have is enough? And so the way the regime is playing with the ideological or ideational content is very situational. It can adapt to the situation, and it has adapted to the war context, right? So it's still, and it was very much the case before February 24, a very kind of patchwork type of bricolage of you take different notions that have different genealogy in Russian intellectual history, you try to make them working together, and that's where the ecosystem I was telling you about are arriving, because you have people who are in favor of one notion as being the leading one, some groups are in favor of other notion, right? Some people specialize in the promoting the notion of Eurasia, some other were specialized in the notion of Russian world, right? Some were really interested in the kind of the memory war, like the instrumentalization of the Second World War memory. Some were really more working about kind of the statism, the military, so indoctrination of young people. So here, all these different ecosystems, they have their own specialty and niches and kind of specific ideational kind of context. The coherence was always secondary for the regime, right? The idea was that, well, as long as you are a patriot of Russia, that you believe that Russia should be a great power and that you trust the regime for making the right decision, then after you can have whatever ideological declension you want, right? You can be a nostalgic of Stalin, you can be a nostalgic of Tsar Nicholas II, right? You can be monarchist, you can be Bolshevik, even if Putin is not a big fan of Bolsheviks. You can be in favor of the Russian Orthodox Church becoming a kind of orthodoxy becoming a state ideology. You can be in favor of Russia remaining secular or plurireligious country, right? You can say that our model is Byzantium and we should go back to the kind of third world narrative, or you can say our model is China and we want a kind of multipolar world, right? You could play with still a lot of different kind of ideological coloring. Good, one of the big kind of one being either being in favor of a very multinational Russian state, playing with the notion of Eurasia, the notion of a community of destiny of Eurasian people, or be much more ethno-nationalist and saying, well, the ethnic Russian should be the dominating group, and that should be kind of recognized, institutionalized, and so on. So there was a lot inside the authorized framework. There was still a lot of little dissociation you could play with. Gradually, with the war, of course, we see that there is an attempt of making all this notion working together and trying to create more coherence. I'm not sure if the idea is really that you need the coherence to make the narrative more convincing toward the population, or it's more the idea that we need to be sure to protect young people from so-called Western liberal decadent ideology and be sure that, so it's difficult to know if coherence really matter per se, or if it's more about how you, the coerciveness of the indoctrination. But clearly since February 24, this has been kind of the kind of work to create the coherence has been at play inside the all this production of ideology. So which kind of doctrinal content we have now? So you always had a very strong narrative that was related to history, to showing the continuity between the Tsarist and the Soviet regime in terms of Russia being a great power, whatever the nature of the political regime was, also with a lot of emphasis on Russia. A geography, the space being the biggest country in the world in terms of space. So these elements, they were always there. But now you can see that another niche that was the groups who were promoting kind of traditional values, you know, like an anti-abortion group, more kind of a traditional gender division. So all those were more on the morality side are now trying to work closer with those who are working on this kind of historical memory, and that is also connected with those who are working more on the kind of the geopolitical aspect of, okay, so Russia is in tension with the West, and so the West is our main enemy. We need to be fighting against a unilateral world led by the US. So all these different arguments, they are slowly getting put together and trying to have them articulated with each other, which was not really the case before. They were still existing as pretty kind of separated niches. I think Ukraine was the meeting points, in fact, of many of these elements, right? Of course, of the tension, the kind of strategic competition with the West, the idea that Ukraine had to choose between who, like, belonging to one or to the West or to the Russian world. But Ukraine was also a kind of critical point for this notion that you have a kind of national unity in Russian history, that you have one cultural body that couldn't be divided except divided by its enemy. And so that's where Putin's, first his 2021 text, and then the different speeches he made at the beginning of the invasion, with this idea, with this argument that in fact there was one united Eastern Slavic nation, the Russian, the Ukrainian, and the Belarusian, and that it's gradually either enemy of Russia or Bolsheviks who kind of divided that united a nation up to create an artificial, in Putin's language, Ukraine. So Ukraine is at the articulation of many of these different niches of ideological production. And so what we have now, we have a mixed also of arguments, if you look about, so one is about this kind of unity of the three Eastern Slavic nations. One is just about, we are just here involved in Ukraine to protect the Donbas population. Sometimes it's expanded to the more kind of supposedly pro-Russian Russian speaker in Ukraine. At the same time, so you have this, what has been identified as a more kind of imperialist vision definition of Russia toward Ukraine, but at the same time, if you look at the way the state is still producing languages about the Russian Federation itself, Putin has been celebrating the multi-ethnicity of Russia much more visibly since February 24, right? Probably as a way to kind of try to keep the unity of the nation, and also as a way to say, well, we are a shared multi-ethnic like community of destiny against the West. And always remember that in that story, the Muslim spiritual board, for example, play also a big role in trying to support the regime. So it's not only the Russian Orthodox Church, it's also the Muslim spiritual board. So it's really important to talk to ethnic minority and especially to Muslim minority in Russia. And then very clearly visible kind of anti-nationalist narrative identifiable in Putin's speech, where the nationalists are of course always the others, right? The nationalist is either Ukrainians or it's the Russians who are fighting on the Ukrainian side, the foreign legion, or it's the West who is nationalist, right? So they are trying to kind of articulate this element with always this kind of obsession for the Second World War, and really the war today being seen as almost a kind of historical reenactment in live condition of the Second World War, and very much using the memory of the war as a rent, right? That's something where you just have to say, like, we will redo it, right? We can repeat it. We did it, we will redo it. So a very kind of rent aspect of using the memory. And the last point that I think is a really interesting one that we see emerging is that the decoupling with the West is now producing or pushing this Russia, this kind of Kremlin ecosystem at producing a narrative that said that Russia is the global south country. And that helps to reactivate the Soviet language of anti-colonialism, anti-imperialism toward the Third World. But it also had a long Russian intellectual history tradition since the 19th century. You had Slavophiles saying that, you know, the West is colonizing culturally, politically, epistemologically, kind of ontologically, Russia. And so this kind of anti-colonial narrative of Russia against the West, and then of Russia for the global South against the West, right? These narratives are kind of really emerging. And what I found them interesting is that it's the only projection of power that Russia is having now, where Russia presents itself as the global power without having to have a regional hegemony. But if you look at all the other projects like Eurasia, Russian world, what makes Russia legitimate in this projection, it's because it's controlled its sphere of influence in the post-Soviet space. When Russia speaks to the global south, you don't need to be a regional hegemon. Just the fact that you are fighting against US unipolarity gives you already the legitimacy, right? And so I think it's interesting in the context of Russia kind of losing ground in the post-Soviet space. So moving now more to the kind of institutional construction, what has been happening since February 24 is that really the presidential administration has really became the core institution much more visibly than before in kind of organizing the framing of this new ideology. It's all people around Sergei Kirienko who have been working with him in his previous position when he was leading Rosatom, the Russian state agency for nuclear. You have several figures. I won't very long on them, but just to tell you that it's usually the name. Honestly, we never have heard about them, right? Just to say that it's people. They are not intellectual producer, right? They are not people who will be like known in the West and even in to a large part of the Russian society as having produced some kind of ideological contents. They are either academics or technocrats whose job is to combine this element, right? So it's a much more technocratic, bureaucratic process of trying to create a narrative and kind of reactivating old Soviet society like the Obshchezvoznanie in charge of promoting new classes. So when you look at what Russia has been, so the two key elements of promotion of what is not called a state ideology, but which is very close to, so the weekly classes for school children called Razgovor o Vazhnom, discussion on what is important. You can look at the website. It's really interesting. You have small kind of vignette of different topics. You have small videos that can be watched with school children and some readings. It has some element of patriotism. It's also very basic kind of civic education. You know, it's celebrating family relationship, like how do you learn to trash, you know, things to respect, you know, nature. How do you celebrate, you know, I don't know, the commemorate the 100 something anniversary of any kind of big Russian cultural figure. So you have some element that you can identify as a kind of patriotism, but it's a pretty, you know, a mild indoctrination that on many aspects would look kind of, you know, civic education you would have in many European country, maybe slightly more, but you cannot see any kind of deep, super ideologically, you know, heavy construction. So it's interesting to look at this website. The new classes that will be launched next academic year for university called the Fundament of Russian Statehood or the DNA of Russia will be so a new mandatory classes for the first semester of all students. The idea being, you see, both to form feeling of patriotism and citizenship, but also to avoid divergences, right? So you also have this idea that youth is a very unreliable part of the Russian population in terms of ideological commitment. And then so the kind of the basis of the text has been released pretty recently. We don't have the full text, yes, but he also, it's a pretty mild language. We even have some Western authors that have been called. You don't see all the kind of usual suspect coming from the radical fringes being quoted there. I mean, you have something on, so five section, what is Russia? It's big country by size. It has a wonderful wild nature. Okay, very classic kind of argument. It's a specific, the Russian state has its own civilization. So that has been this kind of civilizationist narrative has been kind of very present in the official languages for years. It has values, so what is called the pentabasis. So it's becoming kind of one level up in terms of ideological contraction, the pentabasis with different notion about how do you refer to family, to society, to state. So patriotism, trust in institution, tradition, kind of creation. And then there is a part on kind of contemporary history of Russia, which is mostly about just like trust the institution and be a good citizen. And then a part about the challenges of the future and development of the country, which is mostly a kind of anti-Western narrative. So he also compared to, you know, the media language you can see if you watch, you know, the third channel and kind of Solovyov tab, it's still very far away from that, right? It's still a pretty mild, pretty classic patriotic language. At the same time, you have the kind of the non-classic, non-technocratic, non-formal state that is coming with narratives that are much more engaged. And of course, the Russian Orthodox Church has been a key actor in kind of trying to give a religious justification to the war, with Patriarch Kirill kind of talking about the war as being a defensive war of liberation, celebrating those who will be dying. But also we can see more kind of in a cryptic way, an attempt theologically to organize a narrative about the notion of just war, which in Orthodox theology doesn't work, right? That's, I won't go inside the too much of this kind of theological discussion, but the kind of St. Augustine notion of just war is not considered as theologically acceptable in Eastern Christianity, but the church is now working in trying to make it kind of functional. And the idea, and you will see the kind of mirror game with the state language, is that if you have the right to use forces, including war, if your job is to maintain the natural order. And if you think about the way the state has been framing the war, right, in Ukraine, it's very much this idea that, in fact, Russia is defending the world as it should be. And that gives the right to use force. And in that case, violence for the ultimate good, it's not violence because it's fair, right? It's done for a kind of final objective that is legitimate. So all this kind of spiritual warfare argument that is arriving in the Russian public discourse is very much grounded on work that are done not only by the Russian Orthodox Church, but also by more intellectual like figure around the church that are trying to frame the argument that would justify religiously the war. And you may remember also Patriarch Kirill saying that the war is about two civilizations, those accepting LGBT, those accepting gay pride, and those refusing it. So this notion of spiritual warfare is really kind of growing, and the church is playing a role in that, and it's always framed in a kind of ecumenical language to be sure that those who belong to other religion in Russia also may feel included. And of course, the main target there are the Muslim population. So this kind of just war theory is interesting because you can see it in a kind of cryptic way emerging in the state language to justify that the war is a not only if it's fair and it's not really violence, because those who are on the other side, if they are represented a kind of evil forces, are not really humans, and therefore violence is authorized. And then globally, you have kind of eschatological language that has been arriving in the public space in a pretty visible manner with this, which makes me think that the what was the informal state where you had all the radical fringes known for their radical languages and what was the most official, neutral, technocratic languages, there you now have porosity between these two worlds. You still have a technocratic functioning and interpretation of ideology, but you can also feel how much a kind of apocalyptical language has been entering a kind of with biblical reference, which is not something common in kind of everyday Russian political culture. Right, so the World Russian People Council, which is a very nationalist gathering, had a section where Patriarch Kirill called Putin fighter against the Antichrist. They had something about ideological war against Satan. Dugin has been talking about Russia, the new Noah Ark, avoiding a world flooding. Some of the presidential administration figure also have kind of taking that religious language about the country Messiah against the big inquisitor. There have been, as you may know, several narratives on the need to desatanize Russia. In May at the Legal International Forum, there was also several official figures talking about, you know, the need to, in a sense, yeah, continue to the notion of to desatanize Russia. Narishkin advised the Anglo-Saxon to go to their old friend the devil. And as you may know, there was also several of these famous provocative talk show that should be read not literally, but as something that is script and that is part of a kind of entertainment of politics, right? Also saying that, well, all true patriots will have eternal life if we have to have a nuclear war. So all these elements, they make me smile. I take them pretty seriously on the kind of eschatological language arriving in the Russian political culture today with this idea that, okay, something really existential is happening for Russia, and it has this kind of suddenly, it's created this porosity between what was so far a very reasonable technocratic understanding of ideology as really like, let's be sure that young people are just kind of fitting the global frame and will not revolt and will be ready to go to war, and things that are becoming much more kind of radical in their envisioning ideology up to the point of dying or having this kind of apocalyptical vision of what is happening. Very briefly, conclusion, and then I will stop here. So there are several elements that I'm mentioning here. I think one of them that is really the how much importance we want to give to the content of ideology and how much we want to see it more as the kind of, it's a collective practice, you know? If you are in Russia, you open the television and you just let this talk show being there, right, in your background. Doesn't necessarily mean you are listening to everything, you are believing everything, right? But they are just part of your kind of cultural background for many people. What the regime is interested in is it's not having kind of grassroots enthusiastic mobilization. It's to have people who are obedient, right? It's to have a public approval, but not necessarily asking people to feel super personally involved with the war, or at least you have this tension. And I think that tension is exactly the one we have about does Russia need a really state ideology as such, or can it just play with something that is the national idea, not the state ideology, that would just be kind of continuing having a mainstream narrative that is hegemonic, that is marginalizing or silencing all those who don't share that, but that doesn't need to be registered, you know, in all this institutional mechanism of the state as the Marxist-Leninism was. And then what I was mentioning at the end is that you have two interpretations of the need of Russia searching for ideology now. You have the really kind of eschatological language coming from the church, from some radical fringe figure, and then you have the more kind of bureaucratic aspect. And I think they are both in tension. The regime is playing on both of them. They all represent different ecosystems. They were, before February 24, much more divided and not really meeting. Now you can see the porosity of the radical kind of fringe slowly penetrating the kind of the bureaucratic language, and then we won't have time to talk about that, but we can keep that for the discussion. The society is reacting in a very cognitive dissonance aspect and with really like shade of gray in terms of approving the war and developing what has been called by our colleague Jeremy Morris defensive consolidation, that where you try to, you feel in support of whatever the regime is considered to be good, meaning it can be war, but if it's peace, it's also good, right? But just trying to kind of withdraw in personal life and avoid too much involvement in politics, especially at wartime. I will stop here. Thank you for your attention and looking forward for the questions.
Thank you so much, Marlene, for this fascinating and very wide-ranging presentation. I'm sure there will be plenty of questions, but I will start myself, since I have the word. And I was wondering about the work of the presidential administration. So, you told that they had been focusing on the conversations about important things and this new course on the fundamentals of Russian statehood. And first of all, I would like to hear if you could say something about the reception of the conversations about important things. How has this been implemented in the classroom? Do we know something about how this has been taught and potentially resisted? And then you also said that the fundamentals of Russian statehood are now being rolled out, and they will start these classes from next semester. So where do you see the attention going next? Because now you have covered the school system, the higher education. Who is next in line?
Yeah, great question. I think they have been, so the implementation, at least of the weekly classes, has been not entirely easy, right? We don't have so. It's Russia today, it's very difficult to do fieldwork, very difficult to get detailed information for external observer. It seems it had some mixed results, right? We know there have been some parents who were really trying to have their children not attending that class. We can imagine that many teachers will be interpreting the class in their own way, right? And will be playing with the privacy of the classroom in selecting what is really what they consider important. So it's pretty, and that's the regime cannot really control, right? The way each teacher will be spreading the word and how it will be articulated. And as always, the way the teacher is framing it is more important for the impact on the child than whatever will be on the screen, right? So I think the human component will be really important. And on that, the state won't be really able to be, you know, enough inside the classroom to know. I think there have been mixed feeling on the teacher side. Some, of course, official teacher association welcoming that kind of new class. Some teacher being much more kind of nuanced, as we were discussing before. You still have in the society a support for the idea of a state ideology. Right, and we have also surveyed that show that a large majority of the Russian population is in favor of kind of military patriotic education for their children. So I think it's generally accepted what is really happening and what a child can really remember and how it's really influential remain to be seen. For university, I think it will be much more challenging, right? Because you are talking to young people who have access to a lot of diversified information, who are by definition, if I may say, as teenager and young adult, pretty kind of cautious about everything that will be kind of formulated. So I think that we will have to see on how the implementation is working, which kind of resistance is happening. He also, the teachers will have still some freedom in selecting, you know, this, because some elements are, you know, if it's just about kind of learning about the Russian institution and Russian history, you can always comment on the fact that it's a biased reading, but in itself, it's not specifically like terribly ideological. I mean, if you look at a lot of kind of civic education textbooks in many democratic countries, it's still very far from what is history for as an intellectual practice, right? It's you know, you lose the nuances by definition. So I think there will be still a lot of room available for maneuver. The question is how much it will be mandatory, right? How much you will be penalized if you don't attend, if you don't grade well, how much that can be used as a tool to control who is saying what in the classroom. But the text itself, I think, will get kind of mixed result. And many of these bureaucratic measure, they have very mixed result, right? Because the Russian state is not necessarily a very efficient state, right? So that is kind of making all this implementation much milder than they may look on the paper.
And what next?
Oh yeah, what next? Well, I think they have kind of already have a good spectrum of pressure. So I think that will be mostly kind of reinforcing. It's the implementation that will be challenging. Right, I think that in the beginning of the full-scale invasion, so we will be at 18 months of creating this new kind of ideological tool. Now the question is, how do you implement them and does that work? And I think everything that is also para-school kind of military patriotic activities is also something where the regime is really interested in kind of being sure that young people are in line with the regime and especially ready to get mobilized if needed.
Okay, we have a few questions here and we need to use a mic because of our online audience. So we'll start with Skogstad and please introduce yourself when you're posing the question. And since there are many questions, also I would ask you to please ask questions and not have long statements, but please go ahead.
Thank you, Helge. When you discussed the evolvement of what you call the new state ideology of Russia, I don't think that term is very, it's very precise, but let's go along with that. You described the, or rather painted the picture of two different aspects, the contents and the structural forces that were shaping this new state ideology. And doing so, you mentioned the team of Kirienko, and I wonder what those actually, what does imply. I mean, Kirienko was a disaster when he left the premiership back in 98, and since then he has been more or less marginalized in top politics in Russia, but apparently has come back because he took over the Telegram, which was the way of communicating, which is, plays an important role in Russia today. But what is his team and in what way does it work? Could you elaborate a bit on that?
Thank you. Well, it's there is not a lot of things that are necessarily available for us as external actor. I think Kirienko, since he came back to the presidential administration, has been kind of became a quite important figure at the beginning, a very technocratic one, but since the a kind of implementer aspect. But I think in the beginning of the war, he has been one of the leading figure of the regime, also because the presidential administration and his own administration is the one in charge of the new annexed territory and their integration into Russia. And that's a pretty powerful position. So both being in charge of all this kind of ideological construction and of the new annexed territory kind of integration in Russia send the signal that he really has become one of the key figure, even if he's not necessarily visible as some other, not necessarily, you know, it's not Dmitry Medvedev publishing on Telegram or tweeting very often or like Patrushev, but he has become, I think, a key figure of the regime now.
Yes, hi, Anne Jerman, University of Cambridge. So I have two questions. The first is whether you could say something about is there an institutional trajectory of the concept of, or like the leveraging of anti-fascism in the Second World War in general? And I was thinking about early 2000s when sort of memory politics with other post-Soviet states began and whether there is some lineage from that. And the second one is maybe more of a of a comment or thought, but I was thinking about like the audience or population response to this, and I was thinking of a book by Yurchak about the last Soviet generation of and ritualization of Soviet discourse, and whether we are seeing something similar today with sort of a performance which is in between belief and pretense. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, very good question. I mean, on the second one, yeah, I think that's what we are getting now, right? That people are performing support. I mean, you may have people who are active supporters of the war, meaning with a personal engagement, you know, and they're going to front, which is the most kind of the highest level of engagement. They just, you know, like supporting the troop in the rear, right? Like participating, sending money, sending uniforms. And so there are a lot of activities that have been kind of relaunched. But I think the majority of population is performing a very passive support. And you see that in the surveys where when you ask people, would you support continuing the war? Yes. Would you support peace? Yes. Right? And it's the same people responding yes to both, meaning that they are not supporting the war. They are supporting the regime in making the decision of what is the best. Right? And if the best decision is the peace, then it's also very good, and then it's kind of back to business as normal. So I think the performative aspect is important. That doesn't mean that you don't have ideology as a set of belief, and this idea that Russia is at war with the collective West, or more exactly, the West is waging a war against Russia, is, I think, largely shared. And I think that's what has been evolving in terms of also framing of the justification of the war, is that the denazification, demilitarization of Ukraine didn't really work a lot among the population, while framing the war as the war against the West and as a kind of repetition or revival of the Great Patriotic War works much better, right? So that's where you have the kind of co-creational aspect, because the regime can also capture how it works or doesn't work in the society and then adapt the narrative. And I think we are very much in a kind of performative aspect now. And then the anti-fascist language really got gradually important. I think 2005 would be, so you can look at several steps at moments where it's become important already in Putin's kind of second mandate, and then gradually the Crimea annexation and Donbass war were already presented as a kind of repetition of the war and fighting against so-called Ukrainian fascism. So you have several institutions whose job is now to kind of sanctified, right, the memory of the war and this kind of anti-fascist narrative. It's usually institutions, so here it's also more about these different ecosystems. It's usually institutions that relate to the defense ministry, right? So it's really the army which is really in charge of kind of this sacralization, and so all the kind of the military, historical military association that are really working in this kind of sacralization of the memory of the war as much as possible. And then you have all the kind of the diplomatic institution of Russia that can also rely that abroad in trying to promote the anti-fascist narrative, trying to have, you know, like kind of more Soviet type discussion at UN and so on about how do we celebrate, you know, the 1945 victory, how do we try to have other countries signing agreement about the how fighting against revival of fascism or Nazism is important. So you have a world structure that has been kind of elaborated. There is a book that was published by Jane McGlynn very recently about memory makers. That is about all these institutions that have been working in building this kind of anti-fascist narrative.
Next one is here.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Back in 1999, your George Washington University National Security Archive found documents saying that we did promise the Russians not to push NATO east of Germany. Also, in 1999, we did that. We pushed the Kosovo War on the Serbs with Appendix B of the Rambouillet Treaty. I blew the whistle on it in American academia, Henry Kissinger did in the media, and Senator Don Nichols did in the Senate War Powers floor debate when Biden and McCain were trying to get dictatorial powers from the war. Now, 2014 in Kiev, which you mentioned, was a coup. It wasn't a legitimate revolution. It was led by Bernard Henri Levy, who you might know. Then, on February 19th, 2022, Zelensky himself triggered the attack, intimating that the other important clause of our Budapest peace agreement with the Russians, he would break with Ukraine getting nuclear weapons, and 5 days later, the Russians attacked.
Just to remind that.
Yeah, I'm getting there.
Let's go get to the questions.
You mentioned.
Because we have a long list.
You mentioned the anti-fascist approach. And of course, we're on record in the UN as voting against the anti-Nazi resolution. 50 countries, the West, 105 countries, the rest of the world voted for it. Which justifies this image in the Russian mind. Now, and then one other thing, the revelation about the Burisma corruption, Biden accepting a $5 million bribe, may kick the American support out from under the Ukraine war. So if that happens, all this war, Russia has mobilized for a war in the ways you have described, but won't all this ideology, et cetera, relax and eventually disappear as Russia is readmitted into the Western community? Thank you.
Thank you. So there are two elements in your comments question. The first one about, right, interpreting the series of kind of misunderstanding between Russia and the West. And here I think there are different ways, and depending on us, each of us as also citizens, how we want to interpret that. I'm very critical of the West, the way the West has been managing the relationship to Russia and the issue of NATO expansion. But I think what I'm interested here is not trying to say if the Russian regime is right or wrong in the way it's framing the conflict with the West, right? Or what can be the reason that have triggered the conflict. I mean, I'm happy to discuss that, but that's another topic, and I think there are many elements in the Russian perception of this misunderstanding in three decades that makes sense for me also, right? But not all of them. So I think that's part of the discussion about what do we consider as kind of element that can be put on the table about, okay, there was a kind of strategic deadlock developed with shared responsibility by Russia, the West, and kind of post-Soviet nation. So that's one narrative, that's one issue. The second one is, say, what happened after February, in February 22 or 24, is something that is the decision of Russia. You can have the arguments that Zelensky trigger that, but I think it's just different. First, it's another discussion than the one I was having today. And I think for us as scholars, it's important to be able to, you know, we discuss ideology. Doesn't mean some elements are not, I'm not saying everything is wrong. I'm not saying everything is right, right? I'm just trying to understand how it works. I could do the same study for what is happening in the US in terms of ideological production and interpretation of the war, right? In terms of the free world against dictatorship and democracy promotion and how we do that. So I share some of the elements you mentioned, not all of them, but some of them, but it's just another discussion. On your second point, would all this ideological element relax if Russia was reintegrated? Well, it's kind of, you know, politics fiction, because the way Russia would be potentially reintegrated cannot be fully done to the point that all this issue would kind of, you know, collapse on the Russian side, because they have become structural on many ways. And they also have their internal domestic logic on the way the regime is interacting with the population and with the part of the population that doesn't share the regime narrative. So it has also the repressive aspect, I don't think, can disappear rapidly, except in the case of dramatic changes in Russia. So I think you could imagine a kind of slowly reintegration of Russia in one way or another that would relax some of the element. And I continue to think that on the Russian side, you have some ideological flexibility. If they really wanted to say relations with the West are rebuilt on some aspect, they can do that. I think they can build the argument, it's inflexible, and the population will buy it because the population will be fine with that. So I think they have that flexibility. I don't think it's probable that it will happen in the current context, because the West itself, I don't think, has also moved ideologically, right? We also have our own ideological vision of the conflict, and especially several countries, mostly the one from Central Eastern Europe, have also, the war has also become existential in the way they frame their nation building. So here also, there are two sides, right? Russia could potentially relax, but can we relax the way we have been looking at Russia as a kind of totally external other that we don't want to be kind of in interaction with? I don't know. I think for the moment, given the current context, it's really kind of science fiction to hope for that to happen in a kind of short-term future.
Unfortunately, yes. Yes. Next question is here, Claudia. And then I have Jakub and Matthew.
Thank you for a very intriguing and rich presentation. I have two questions, or perhaps even three. And the first one is somewhat related to Jerman's. It's about the need of the regime for active support for the war. And it's also related to what you talked about a just war, framing it as a just war. Because what we see, for example, in the Murmansk region, in the Kola Peninsula, is a governor, Andrei Chibis, who is very actively supporting the war with his set T-shirts, set on his car. He's been one of the main promoters, I would say, among the Russian governors. And he also stages these grand humanitarian actions among the population in Murmansk and in Murmansk Oblast. And I would say this is aiming at something more than just performing support. It triggers, as I see it in the internet, in social media, it actually triggers emotions among the Russian population, local population. So they gather all kinds of aid for their adopted region, Primorsky Krai, in Donbas. The last thing I saw is that Murmansk County is financing 230 children from Primorsky Krai to go to this Krasnodar camp or whatever. I don't remember where, but somewhere in the Russian south. So, but I would like to hear your thought. Is this, will we see more of this in the future? I totally agree with you that the regime probably does not need active support for the war, but still on a regional level, will we see more of this? Not only acceptance, but actually support. And then my second question related to that is, would you say the governors are part of this ideological infrastructure, the infrastructure of ideology? To what extent have they become more important during the last 1.5 years? Because as I see, Chibis is a prominent example of someone who has become, and then last question, to what extent do you see this need for state ideology reflected in the new foreign policy concept from March this year? Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much. When we talk about the kind of the performative aspect of a large part of the support, or at least the approval of the war, we were looking at the kind of the average everyday population. Yeah, I think for political elites, it's different, right? I think the political elite have been shaken by the beginning of the war because they were not informed, right? It was coming. So I think there was a first moment of kind of panic and then a kind of stabilization. And then I think the war, because it's created this kind of, it had this kind of aspirational aspect where political elites have to make a choice and they have to play. So it's opened a new space in a sense for kind of political competition inside the elites. Some are taking the decision to become more visible in terms of supporting the war. You also have governors who have almost never mentioned the special military operation. Right? And I think it can depend. And I don't think we have a clear study of at the governor level about who did what and for which reason. It can be their personal strategy, where they think they belong, right? If it were good for them to insist on being very visible in pro-war, or on the contrary, being silent, maybe it's depend on how they interpret their own local electorates, who are their voters, who are their patron in the system, on which camp. So I think they have their room of maneuver and their own kind of political strategy. And then they have an interpretation of what their basis is, and they play with that. But I think it's an important topic, and I don't think it has been really studied, all the kind of regional declension of the war, which regions are kind of traditionally maybe more patriotic than other, which elites, how regional elites are playing. I think the war potentially creates, yeah, this kind of social promotion mechanisms that can be of use for some of the regional elites in trying to be more visible. I mean, Kadyrov is a specific case, and Sobyanin, in a sense, is also a specific case, because being the mayor of Moscow is always a specific a role. And then depending if their region is connected to one of the annexed region, that also change, right? The strategy, the framing. If you are spending a lot of your regional budget for another region, you also need to frame it in such a way that you can sell it to your local population. And sorry, I forgot the last question. The foreign policy. Yeah, I mean, the foreign policy is really interesting to read. And you have, like, if I remember correctly, 22 mentions of Eurasia. Obolshaya Evrasia, either Eurasia alone or big Eurasia, greater Eurasia. So you can see, and then the narrative, the anti-colonial narrative is really very visible, either in a more kind of classic multipolar world dimension, or much clearly at the kind of the West as being a neo-imperial, neo-colonial power, and Russia helping the global South, and especially Africa. The part on Africa is a pretty long one. So I think all these elements are there, right? But so Russia, the state civilization is very clearly formulated. Eurasia is there, and then kind of anti-colonialism and kind of Russia as being part of the global South and decoupling with the West. It's really kind of clearly formulated in the foreign policy concept, yeah.
But I think it's interesting what you say about the governors and how it's really up to them and the local conditions. So it's not an order, it's not a mobilization, it's up to the local initiative to a great degree, and what is beneficial for the individual governor to hook up to this or not?
No, I think that's what is complicated in the Russian political system, is that it's always top down and bottom up at the same time. I mean, they are probably, depending on who is the governor, with whom is he connected, does he have personal connection to Putin or to Kirienko or to Patrushev or not, he can be invited to be more active or decide by himself. His region can be selected. I think it's also not only depend of the governor, it depends which kind of big industry do you have in your, right? If you are producing, if you are a region with a big kind of military industrial complex, you know you will get state order, right? Business will be good. So you have every interest as probably being more active if you have both constituencies and the potentiality of being state order commissioned to your own kind of regional businesses. So I think there are a lot of criteria that have to be taken into consideration. And I don't think we have a study that we look and try to identify the criteria that make that some governor has been pretty active and some haven't, and what can be the reason for them.
There is a correlation.
Yeah.
But you have to use the microphone if you want people to hear. And you'll get the microphone later on. Jakub, please. And if you introduce yourself.
My name is Jakub Godzimski. I'm a research professor at this institute. And I have only three points. One is...
Is it not on?
Maybe. I have only three points. One is about the purpose of this whole operation, because when you implement some measures, then you aim at achieving something. You have mentioned many times that it's about pacification and about making people not being engaged too much into this, but I think that there are also some other dimensions. And then the second one is that one could have an impression that this focus on providing people with some ideologies of a kind of new is a new finding, but we know that the whole issue of political technology, how you use information space in order to influence choices of people, is a part of the kind of broader picture in Russia. And then the third question is that, and we have also seen similar previous attempts at devising the national idea. In 1996, Yeltsin declared that there is a need for a national idea, and we have also that the Soviet authorities were very much preoccupied. They had a kind of idea, because this was to promote communism, not only in Russia, but also abroad, which was also one of the issues that Russia used in order to promote its policies abroad. And then the third issue is that this is something that is taking place in the information space. And this is also definitely a part of a broader set of topics having to do with Russia's use of information space in order to promote its policies, both on the home front, but also abroad. So if you could provide some comments on those three questions.
Very good. Yeah, on the first one, the purpose of what is what is to be achieved. I think something that I didn't mention is, of course, that everything is, I mean, all this kind of national idea in the broader sense is getting more and more securitized, right? And I think that's what we have been seeing since gradually also, it's step by step, right? That it's gradually over 23 years, it's the Siloviki who are more and more in charge of kind of promoting that. And I think it's also probably the tension we see in how it should be framed, should it be really officialized as ideology or not. All these discussions are very much also, you can see the tension between the Siloviki who would like it formalized as much as possible, because in that case you have repressive tools as public policy that are easier to use, and those who are more civilian and who think you can make it happening in a much more organic way. And I think for very long, the vision of the regime, and that's where the kind of polytechnology are arriving, was the idea that it will happen organically, right? You just help to shape the narrative, the media landscape, and then the population by itself, right? It's happened like, you know, it works organically. There is this kind of meeting between the top down and the bottom up, and that will work. And if that doesn't work, and that has been the interpretation of the regime, that it doesn't work enough, and you have people who are liberal, dissident, or the youth that is not enough, like in line, you have to become repressive. And that's where the kind of the hope for something happening organically doesn't work. And that's where you have to come up with things that are much more kind of Soviet inspired about, let's do a class, let's teach that, let's have this kind of activities. And then the Siloviki, it's also giving jobs, right? All this, it's a business also, right? And it's also comforting the Siloviki. And then, well, if you have mandatory classes, it's also mean you will have a job for people to check if it's well done. And then you will have people to kind of be persecuted if it's not well done, the teacher, the students, and so on. So it's also kind of reinforcing the Siloviki's kind of job at checking the everyday activities of the Russian citizen. And then the information space, yeah, I think there is always this kind of big fear from the Russian elites that they don't control the information space, right? That the population can access elements that are creating, dissension in what is hoped to be this kind of national consensus. And then in terms of how it is spread abroad, I mean, we can see that I don't think they were, after February 24, I don't think the Russian state imagined that, for example, RT and Sputnik would be banned so rapidly from the European kind of public space. So they lost a tool of influence that they have been building and investing on over the years pretty rapidly. They have been trying to bypass that by, you know, being investing Telegram, creating all this mirror website where you can still read kind of Sputnik type of news, but it just, they lost a lot of their European audience, that for sure. And they were not prepared for that. They also have lost another aspect. I mean, they have lost a lot of the soft power just because of the invasion itself. But even all these entrepreneurs of influence who are traveling to Europe, well, they cannot travel to Europe anymore, right? Their money has been frozen. So all this, both the media aspect and the personal connection to some European far right or far left groups, that has been largely destroyed, right? And we see that in the global perception in Europe of even among the far right or those who are more kind of Russophile or pro-Russian, how it has been kind of much more difficult to be articulated. But what we have seen is RT and especially Sputnik entirely reorienting themselves toward the global south, right? They were already pretty much active, but that's very visible. So one example we have is because, for example, both RT and Sputnik, the French section was at the same time speaking to the French audience, so with a kind of far-right narrative, but at the same time speaking to French-speaking African audience with a narrative that was pretty much the opposite, right, of the one they were telling to the French-speaking audience, a kind of anti-European, like pan-Africanist, anti-colonial narrative. So all those kind of teams who were on the French-speaking side got kind of reoriented toward feeding Africans and kind of Maghreb audience because they are French speakers. So you can see that they are trying to reorient and really develop. So the French speaking artist Sputnik really working for Africa. Now the Spanish one being very strong for Latin America. So they are trying to speak more and more to the global south. And there have been some interesting research done on how it's, you know, it's working, not working, seems to be pretty much kind of working pretty well. So I think there will be strategy of both trying to re-speak again to European audience, but that will be pretty challenging, and then trying to really invest into speaking to the global south and creating a kind of base. And of course, through the global south, you can hope to take back, to speak back to some of the European audience, right? So it's pretty developed strategies that they have been kind of, and yeah, for example, there have been good studies showing how much RT has been using anti-colonial narrative and kind of pan-Africanist narrative much more visibly since February 24, right? Especially so, I think Africa is really, Africa and Latin America are really the kind of the two key region that Russia is targeting now.
We have a few minutes left. I have three people on my list, so if we can just collect them, because it's nice and warm outside and you're stuck in this not so comfortable room. So Matthew, Odgunnar and Petya.
Yeah, just to make a quick point about the regional governors, the missing link is Kirienko has been responsible for the replacement of the regional heads for many years, and part of the criteria is that they can win elections or they can be sufficiently popular. So there's a correlation between the quiet regional heads and they have elections in 2023 or 2022 and they don't have good ratings. So that's one point, very briefly. The question is, do the inevitable thing and bring the focus back to Putin? because based on what you've been saying, it seems like we still have this question. Is Putin a centrist, a balancer, who tries to stay above all of the ideological meta-factions? He is not adopting any ideological program completely, or he is not, he's staying above party politics. His involvement in United Russia is, you know, questionable. Is this because he's like a traditional autocrat? He wants to keep channels open. He wants to understand different opinions. He wants to have different groups as consultants. And so we shouldn't expect it's likely under Putin he'll move to some North Korea model of one party, state ideology.
Thanks. With regard to the claim that there was given a promise from the West to someone in the East that NATO would never move beyond East, beyond Germany, eastwards, I think we need to bear in mind a couple of facts. First of all, this claim is mainly based on what the then American Secretary of State, James Baker, said, or is alleged to have said, in a conversation with then the Soviet President Gorbachev and the Soviet Foreign Minister Shevardnadze on the 9th of February 1990. That was, of course, many years before the membership of NATO's countries east of Germany was ever an issue. But also it was at that time when the Soviet Union was still in existence, when the issue of membership, NATO membership to Eastern European countries arose. The Soviet Union was no longer in existence. So whatever promises might have been given, it was to an entity which didn't exist. So such promises would in any case have been null and void. But the point is that Baker never did make a promise. That has been testified time and again by Gorbachev himself and Shevardnadze. So I think there is no reason to continue to believe in that particular myth. Also, Baker had, of course, no mandate, no authority to make any kind of promise about this at that time or later. And in addition,
try to move to a question.
Well, yeah. Okay, I think I'll leave it at that.
So we leave it as a comment, and then we have a question from Petya, and then we wrap up.
It is in completely different direction. It is about the methodology and how can we measure loyalty. And I guess it is probably with looking at the trust in some institutions. Before the war, it was a very high trust in the presidentship, in the church, in the military, and FSB. The new state ideology resonates very much with values that are vested in this ideology. Is it top down again, or is it bottom up? Is it kind of interaction there? You see some connections? Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. So on the first question on Putin himself, well, first I would dissociate the kind of the party structure in Russia. I think there is no strategy of having one party in Russia. They have every interest in having a multiplicity of party and of actors that are offering different political offer to different audience. And I don't see why they would be kind of trying to changing that as long as they feel they control these different party. What is happening, I mean, none of us knows what is happening with Putin himself. I think he still projects himself as, of course, being above party politics, because if you are the representative of the nation and of the state, and you have this kind of grand vision of yourself and the role you bring to Russian history, you are above, you know, small level kind of party politics, and probably also above the war in a sense, right? That if you can decide that people can die for a bigger cause, it's because you see yourself as a kind of higher level. Is he a centrist or a balancer? I think on many aspects he is. That on is trying to feed different audience, try to make a narrative that is kind of, you know, all encompassing. So you can be Tsarist, Soviet, kind of, so there is room, even on gender issue, there is kind of a kind of values. He tried to be kind of moderate. That doesn't mean that the regime is not explicitly giving room to more radical version to exist. But I think himself is trying to kind of have this kind of all-encompassing vision. At the same time, it seems from what we know that he also has some specific beliefs, right? The triune nation, this idea that really Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus are one nation that were divided by the Soviet construction, and it's kind of, he always had very anti-Lenin, very strong criticism of Lenin, seems to be very much his own personal view that he has been implementing that are not necessarily shared by the rest of the Russian political elite. So I think there are elements where it's really him, and there are that elements that are kind of part of the game and the kind of construction of narrative that would feed different audience. But it's pretty difficult, I guess, for us to kind of disentangle all that. And on the question of measuring loyalty, yeah, I think you have you can measure loyalty by default, which is you measure those who are not loyal and all the others are loyal, right? What does that mean? What do they think when they are alone in, you know, their kitchen? We don't know, but I think in the sense the regime doesn't care. I mean, you can be anti-war if you say that in your kitchen to your family member, as long as you perform outside. Either you silence yourself. You even don't have to perform. You just have to be silent, right, and not showing disloyalty. The measurement about, like, which institution do you trust, I think it's both bottom up and top down. I think if we look over the years about, for example, the measure of what are you proud of in Russia, that has been evolving, right? The army was not so high 10 years ago. You had more kind of cultural, historical
elements that were there, and then gradually the army got up. So that is probably a political construction. And I think on many aspects that the idea that Russia needs to be a great power was always very strongly and largely shared by a large part of the population. But what you define by great power doesn't necessarily mean a military great power, right? So I think the militarization of great powerness is something that the regime built over the year and the population kind of accepted it. But you had other version of great powerness that would have been less military visible. I think the relationship to the church is also ambivalent, right? It's the church is legitimate as a symbol of the nation, as kind of sending some signal about the social order and the values. But when the church is really trying to enter private life and give direction to people about what you can do, not do in terms of your body, your sexuality, and so on, I think you have it has less support, right? So I think it's all this issue of loyalty depends on if it's like performing the loyalty externally or accepting the intrusion of the state of the church in your private life. And I think the war is testing that, because when you are sent to the front or when you have one a loved one sent to the front, it's an intrusion into your private life at the core, right? And that's where it's testing, in a sense, loyalty really very, very deeply. And it works so far, largely.
And on that, I am afraid we have to wrap up. But thank you so much, Marlene, for sharing your insights and your research with us. Thank you to you in the audience for coming on a nice summer afternoon in Oslo, and to our online audience as well for joining us. And please join me in giving a big hand to Marlene, and welcome back in the fall.